Albright, and it is my pleasure to welcome you here today, this morning, to our worship service. If you're watching here today on Sunday morning, or if it's Tuesday and you're just tuning in now, that's great. We're glad to have you. It's a great time to worship the Lord. If you're here today watching with great thanksgiving in your heart for all that God's been doing in your life, if you're here today because you're seeking faith, or if you're here today because you're in need of hope, then this is your table, and we welcome you. So to help us get ready today, let's go ahead and take a moment simply to get our places ready. There's so many distractions going on, so let's just take a moment to get everything cleared off, you know, your cereal bowls and other things running around. Let's just kind of get ready and to center our hearts, okay? So what I'd like you to do is right now is to sit back, to take a deep breath, to know that you have been in the presence of God throughout the night. God has been present with you as soon as you put your feet on the floor this morning. God is present with you right now. So let us pray. Assist us, we ask, Heavenly Father, with the presence of your Holy Spirit to bring from within us, Lord, the worship that you are due. We love you, Lord, and we're here today to lay our lives before you again and to receive that word that you would like to speak to us. So defend us, Lord, from every distraction. Defend us, Lord, from every work of our enemy. And we pray, Lord, that you would make our places right now separated unto you, a holy place for worship. Amen. We have a wonderful service today. So let's go ahead and begin with a really great song, I Will Lift Up My Eyes.
My heart,
Bless the Lord who forgives all our sins. His mercy endures forever. Jesus said, the first commandment is this, hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is the only Lord. Love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul, with all your mind and with all your strength. The second is this, love your neighbor as yourself. There is no other commandment greater than these. So, assured of God's grace and forgiveness, let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Saying together, most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen.
Kyrie eleison, Christe eleison, Kyrie eleison. We are lost and alone. Sin tempts our souls. Spirit, come guide us, lead us back home. Kyrie eleison, Christe eleison. Kyrie
The Lord be with you. Now let join me together with the prayer for the fifth Sunday of Advent. Almighty God, you alone can bring into order the unruly wills and affections of sinners. Grant your people grace to love what you command and desire what you promise, that among the swift and varied changes of the world, our hearts may surely there be fixed where true joys are to be found. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. As we prepare to go to our readings today, pay close attention to Psalm 51. And so now, our readings.
The first lesson is from Jeremiah. The days are surely coming, says the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and the house of Judah. It will not be like the covenant that I made with their ancestors when I took them by the hand to bring them out of the land of Egypt, a covenant that they broke, though I was their husband, says the Lord. But this is the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, says the Lord. I will put my law within them, and I will write it in their hearts, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people. No longer shall they teach one another or say to each other, know the Lord, for they shall all know me, from the least of them to the greatest, says the Lord. For I will forgive their iniquity and remember their sin no more. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Please join me in Psalm 51. Have mercy on me, O God, according to your loving kindness.
In your great compassion, blot out my offenses.
Wash me through and through from my wickedness.
And cleanse me from my sin.
For I know my transgressions.
And my sin is ever before me.
Against you only have I sinned.
And done what is evil in your sight.
And so you are justified when you speak.
And upright in your judgment.
Indeed, I have been wicked from my birth.
A sinner from my mother's womb.
For behold, you look for a deep within me.
And I will make me understand wisdom secretly.
Purge me from my sin, and I shall be pure.
Wash me, and I shall be clean indeed.
Make me hear of joy and gladness.
That the body you have broken may rejoice.
Hide your face from my sins.
And blot out all my iniquities.
Create in me a clean heart, O God.
And renew a right spirit within me.
Cast me not away from your presence.
And take not your Holy Spirit from me.
Give me the joy of your saving help again.
And sustain me with your bountiful spirit.
The second reading is from Hebrews. Christ did not glorify himself in becoming a high priest, but was appointed by the one who said to him, "You are my son, today I have begotten you." And he says that also in another place, "You are a priest forever, according to the order of Melchizedek." In the days of his flesh, Jesus offered up prayers and supplications with loud cries and tears to the one who was able to save him from death. And he was heard because of his reverent submission. Although he was a son, he learned obedience through what he suffered. And having been made perfect, he became the source of eternal salvation for all who obeyed him, having been designated by God from a high priest according to the order of Melchizedek. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to St. John. Glory to you, Lord Christ. Now among those who went up to worship at the festival were some Greeks. They came to Philip, who was from Bethsaida in Galilee, and said to him, "Sir, we wish to see Jesus." Philip went and told Andrew. Then Andrew and Philip went and told Jesus. Jesus answered them, "The hour has come for the Son of Man to be glorified. Very truly I tell you, unless a grain of wheat falls into the earth and dies, it remains just a single grain. But if it dies, it bears much fruit. Those who love their life lose it, and those who hate their life in this world will keep it for eternal life. Whoever serves me must follow me, and where I am, there will my servant be also. Whoever serves me, the Father will honor. Now my soul is troubled, and what should I say? Father, save me from this hour? No. It is for this reason that I have come to this hour. Father, glorify your name." Then a voice came from heaven. "I have glorified it, and I will glorify it again." The crowd standing there heard it and said that it was thunder. Others said, "An angel has spoken to him." Jesus answered, "This voice has come for your sake, not for mine. Now is the judgment of this world. Now the ruler of this world will be driven out. And I, when I am lifted up from the earth, will draw all people to myself. He said this to indicate the kind of death he was to die. The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Christ.
So, good morning again. So, if you know me, you know I love our Episcopal worship. I love the prayer book. I didn't grow up in church, and I didn't become a Christian in Episcopal church, but I became Episcopalian. One of the reasons I love the liturgy. But there's a real serious drawback to our liturgy as we're trying to hear God speak one word to us. We have a million other words going on in our service. We have a million words. Three different readings, a psalm, prayers. So here's what I'd like you to do. I'm going to read to you three verses from Psalm 51. What I'd like you to do just for a moment is to imagine that these are the only words in our service. These three verses. There's nothing else, just three verses to listen to, to try to allow them to touch our hearts, all right? So here's three verses from Psalm 51. Hide your face from my sins and blot out all my iniquities. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. Cast me not away from your presence, and take not your Holy Spirit from me. Hide your face from my sins, and blot out my iniquities. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. Cast me not away from your presence, and take not your Holy Spirit from me. The Psalms can be really lovely expressions, prayers sometimes to God. They have been used as part of liturgies for more than 3,000 years. A wonderful way to be able to bring all the thoughts and concerns of a whole congregation all together and have one confession, have us read or sing a psalm together, just to be able to like put us all together into one concern expressed in these psalms. And in that way, they're very beautiful. But in a deeper way, the Psalms, and especially this psalm, Psalm 51, can really be more than that to you personally. This Psalm 51 is the kind of psalm that you can join in as a prayer, your own prayer, very privately, between you and God. And it becomes more than a prayer. It becomes a real help, because Psalm 51 can help you see your own heart. Psalm 51 can reveal with clarity and honesty the truth of your own heart about the thing that is most important. You know, in our Christian life, we have things that we think we got to hold fast to and believe. That's true. There are things that we do. We come to church. We have liturgies. We have worship. We have confessions. We have all these things going on. But at the very crux, the very heart of it, all those things, what do you think God is really after for you, if not your heart? Not your heart as, you know, a pulsating, workable biological factor that makes the blood move in your life. But no, the heart as the very center from which you think and live. It takes all your emotions, all your understanding, and all your will, the very heart of you. Psalm 51 can help you see it as it really is. You know, I really believe that we do a lot of things to anesthetize ourselves from seeing stuff that's really hard in our lives. I think we do a lot of things so that we won't necessarily have to feel all of our fears. I think we do certain things to be able to like be in denial and not be in touch with how our failures affect us. We can do things to block off the pain of it all. And you know what? One of the easiest ways that you get rewarded for is to stay busy. We can stay so busy that we never really get down to like our hearts. And when it comes to church, even our liturgy can be so busy that we're saying and doing and following and standing and kneeling and singing that you can be very churchified and yet never get to your heart. What I mean by your heart really today is this one thing. What is the disposition of your heart toward God? I don't mean, do you believe in God? Can you sign a confession? Can you stand with reassurance and be able to say the creed? But I mean, where is your heart? Where is your heart after God? Hide your face from my sins and blot out my iniquities. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. Cast me not away from your presence and take not your Holy Spirit from me. If you were to find out that a small group of people got together for a particular liturgy in ancient Israel, and they said, hey, we need something penitential for New Year and Yom Kippur. We need a penitential psalm. Write something. If you heard that a committee got together and spent 6 months together and wrote Psalm 51, and then everybody said it together, you would say, wow, quite an accomplishment. What a beautiful work that really is really great for us to enter into. It would be a work of genius. But the fact of it is, it wasn't written by a committee for a purpose. It was written by one person, when suddenly his heart was revealed to him. It was a person who, after a lifetime of having God be the most important thing in his life, he realized in a moment how far he had drifted, and how far his heart, which had been once the only thing that really mattered was God, how far he had fallen from that. And when he saw it, he wrote Psalm 51, not as a way to confess sins, and so that way God would have to forgive him. He wrote it because he wasn't just a person who had sinned, but he realized that he was lost. Other than Jesus, the one person in Scripture that is written the most about is David. And everybody, in a way, knows David. He's got some famous stories which seem to go beyond Scriptures and beyond religious circles. And we think about David and Goliath. Got the NCAA tournament going on right now. And how often will a team that comes into the tournament, poorly ranked, and like a 15 seed, beats a number one seed, and they'll say, oh, it was a David and Goliath kind of battle. So we're somewhat familiar with him. But there's really so much to him. His time when he became king of Israel, that becomes the beginning of Israel's golden era. His son Solomon goes ahead and builds the great temple, and there's this time of prosperity. And so it all kind of begins with David. So he wasn't just a guy who kind of, beat up Goliath, on that day. He becomes the king of Israel and begins a whole new era. He's also known as a guy who we think of him as, oh, he's that kid, kind of the who succeeded against all odds. prophet Samuel came to his father and said, one of your sons is going to be anointed the heir apparent to Saul the king. And his father was overjoyed. And so Samuel said, so let's see your sons. And he brought each one of them from oldest down. And he said, this is the, must be the one you met. He's the strongest. He's the smartest. He's the fastest. He's the best talker. He brought them in one after the other. And Samuel looked at all of them and said, it's not any of these. And so they said, well, I do have one more son. You know, he's the guy that we let him like watch sheep. And David becomes the one who becomes the heir to the throne. David was also famous, as it turns out, in an era where there were regional wars and battles all the time. He became known as a great warrior. In fact, there was a song written about him that was called David, Killer of His 10,000s. You can imagine how that came around in a time when people were doing hand-to-hand combat all the time. He was a great warrior. But more than a great warrior and against the all odds and the one who would be king, he was known as a man after God's own heart. That's why he was chosen, because this phrase that later, even in the New Testament, it's written in the book of Acts, and they say, remember him, it said, and God testified to David as a man after God's own heart. The thing that made him unique wasn't his warrior skills, and it wasn't his just because he was a against the all odds guy. It's because of his heart. At the core of his being, the essential part of that made his personality and his being unique was that he was a man after God's own heart. And despite all this kind of macho stuff that he did, he was a tremendous worshiper. So many psalms were written by David that in modern times, when they were writing new translations in English, if the headers did not have a name of who wrote the psalm, they just figured it was David, because he had written so many other ones that said a psalm of David. He wrote these incredible songs and hymns and psalms. One time when they found the ark, not like ark as in Noah's ark, but ark as in, you know, the Ark of the Covenant, you know, Indiana Jones ark, that was the symbol of God's very presence. And the Philistines had come in one time in a battle. They'd ransacked Jerusalem, and they'd taken Israel's most precious item, the ark, and they'd taken it off. Later, when David had just become king, they said, hey, we found the ark. It's in this guy's barn. And so instead of just going and bringing it back in and placing it in a place for them to worship, David set up one of the greatest processions of Israel's history. 30,000 people were in this procession. 30,000 people. There were warriors. There were singers and dancers. There were musicians. Priests were the whole way sacrificing to God in great celebration of returning the ark. And I don't know if they're really food trucks, but let's just say, along the way, they were giving away free food so that everybody was celebrating. Everybody was showing up to Jerusalem to see the return. And there in the middle, as it came into the city, David in his royal robes goes out, and he couldn't help himself to think that God's presence returning. And he took off all the royal stuff, and just in the stuff that he wore underneath, he began dancing before the ark, dancing before the Lord. I don't know if you've ever seen a movie, or you've been to an Orthodox Jewish wedding, men dancing. This is part of the culture. And he got up and danced like almost like, you know, a man out of control. He danced just right before the Lord. And it was such that his wife, who saw it from a window, was so terribly embarrassed that when he came in after the whole thing, she said, oh, that was great. You know, you took off your royal robes and there in your undergarments, you're out there making a fool of yourself, humiliating yourself in front of all the servants. And David said, is that what you think? I wasn't dancing in front of servants. I was dancing before the Lord, and I will dishonor myself in other ways to be able to please the Lord. He had a heart for God, a down deep, what he wanted to do more than anything else in knowing God was to worship God and to do what God wanted, to have his heart and God's heart be aligned and be one. Oh, he's one of the most influential people in our worship of ever in the whole universe. There came a time, however, Perhaps it was because he was older. Perhaps it was because some of the generals said, look, we can't have you coming out to our regional battles again and again, because you know, what happens if you get killed or what happens if you get captured? So David had to stay back in the big palace. And maybe it was because he was missing war. Maybe it was, you know, kind of like a midlife crisis. I guess I'm too old for battle. What am I good for? He, from a distance, falls in love with this woman, somebody else's wife. And he uses his power and position, his authority as king, to make her part of his. And when she comes to him and tells him later that she's pregnant, he realizes that he's about to lose his reputation, his honor, what else? And he panics. And he makes a plan to cover it up, but it doesn't work. And so the only way he can see his way out is that he arranges with one of his most trusted generals to have this lady's husband go to the front of the battle, and just as he gets there, to have all the other troops back off so that he's killed. He basically sets him up and has him murdered to cover up for his transgression. And he would have gotten away with it because nobody knew. And the only people that did, this other guy, he knew, but he was too loyal to David. He would have never told. David's secret was sure. Until this prophet Nathan, a guy who David trusted, came to him, basically, and God had spoken to him about the prophet about it. And he confronts David and tells him, you know, that God has revealed what you have done. And for the first time in the whole incident, the story takes a dramatic break. Here's the guy that wrote these beautiful Psalms, Psalm 23, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. Suddenly, this man after God's own heart realizes that his heart has changed. His heart has changed. His heart toward God has changed. And he's betrayed not just his friends and not just the nation, but in Psalm 51, it's like he's getting it clear with God, against you only have I sinned. He has betrayed God, but we have a hard time with that. We tend to make it more like, well, you sin, you have to get forgiveness. He betrayed his heart of hearts, the one who loves him the most, the one he loves the most. He has somehow gotten so mixed up. Was it his personal pride? Was it the fact that he got so successful? But in somehow he's out of touch with his heart with God. And he's broken. He's broken. And he says, hide your face from my sins. That is to say, I cannot bear the thought of you even looking at me at this point. My shame is so intense. Hide your face, cover your face. Don't look at me. Blot out my iniquities, which is literally means to take your pen and ink and to try to cover it up, blacken it out so that you cannot read it. And there's no just simple forgiveness. He says, he begs, create in me a clean heart, O God. My spirit has become so burdened, so weary, so caught up in other things that I need a new spirit within me. And then the heart of the prayer, cast me not away from your presence. And take not your Holy Spirit from me. He was the most successful king in the history of Israel to that point. They wrote songs about him. They cheered for him. He was a hero to all. But it doesn't matter because deep within, he realizes he's betrayed his own heart to God, the thing that made him who he was. He doesn't pray, oh, Lord, defend me. Don't let people find out. I want to be king forever. Oh, don't mess it up. Don't let this go and affect my the generations. No, it's just about his heart and God. renew a right spirit within me. How does it happen? When we have moments and we think about how deeply we are loved by God, maybe you've had a moment like that. Maybe it was during Holy Week. Maybe it was on a Good Friday service where you saw the implements that eventually led to Jesus' death presented, or you think about him dying because of his love for you, because of your sins. Maybe sometimes you've been affected for that. And there have been seasons of your life where you've said, Lord, I want to live for you alone. Not just like give me success or forgive my sins or I want to go to heaven. No, it's about you, Lord. Maybe you've had that moment where your heart has been open and you realize that God is all that you've ever dreamed of and that God is the closest thing to you, the most important thing to you. How is it that our hearts can betray us? And worse still, how is it that our hearts can betray us and then we become so calloused that we're not even aware of it? When we confess our sins, I admit that there's sometimes I feel like it's a bank transaction. Yes, I can think of these sins. If I confess them, God's obligated to forgive them. So here's a $50 sin, a $5,000 sin. Like Lord, can you pay? Can you cancel these debts? See, we're all good now. And I'll go live. That is not what it's all about. It's about our hearts to God. And so, forgiveness, we begin to understand, is the most valuable commodity, the most valuable aspect of love that we have. Because God forgave David. And that 2,000 years later, after this incident, he is still remembered as God saw him, a man after God's own heart. Not a perfect man, not a guy who did everything right, but a man after God's own heart. Because of God's forgiveness. And because of God's forgiveness, David could forgive himself and live with his heart toward God. And when you know that kind of forgiveness, you become liberal in forgiving others. If you don't know that kind of forgiveness and you keep your heart guarded, how can you forgive others? You'll eke it out. Have they done enough to deserve forgiveness? No. It's about God's forgiveness to us for things that we could never pay back. It allows us to be generous in our forgiveness to others. So, next week begins Holy Week with Palm Sunday. Palm Sunday, that weird Sunday where we begin with great thanksgiving and then we end with Jesus on the cross. And then we walk through the events with Maundy Thursday and Good Friday, and then the service of light on Saturday. This is a time of year that you really need to take the time back for yourself and find a way, perhaps through Psalm 51, to be able to open yourself to seeing your heart and asking this question, where is my heart with God? And can God create in me a new heart and renew a right spirit within me? Because the last thing you ever want in this world is to be cast away from his presence, the presence of the one who's the source of life, who loves you more than you can ask or imagine. So in this time of penitence, of Lent and Holy Week, allow yourself, be courageous with yourself to see your heart before God as it really is. Ask for God's grace, and then ask for the grace to be forgiven and to forgive others with that kind of generous spirit that God forgives us. Because the goal is not just to be forgiven, but to be a person after God's own heart. So I say these words this morning to encourage you in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen. All right, before we move on too quickly, a couple things I have to tell you. One is right now, we have a person in the building right now available at just call the number for the church who can pray with you for about anything. They can assist you in praying for someone else if you'd like. They can assist you in praying. Perhaps it's an issue of your heart. Maybe you realize that you have stuff that you need to get right and you say, I need to pray with somebody. go ahead and take that opportunity and dial that number. They're going to put it up on the screen again for you right now. But don't let it, how could you let the moment pass? It's a great gift to have someone to pray with you, and you can do that right now by calling in. Secondly, if there are other prayers you'd like to do, you'd like to add to our service, be able to put those in your chat right now, whether it's Facebook or whether you're on Zoom, but send your prayers in and we will include them in the prayers of the people. All right. Now our service continues with the words of the Nicene Creed. Saying together, we believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshiped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. And now I'd just like to give you a minute, just a minute for you to go ahead and type your prayers, your intercessions, and your thanksgivings in, and then we'll put them all together as we pray together the prayers of the people. So let us begin. Father, we pray for your holy Catholic Church that we all may be one. Grant that every member of the Church may truly and humbly serve you, that your name may be glorified by all people. We pray for all bishops, priests, and deacons, that they may be faithful ministers of your word and sacraments. We pray for all who govern and hold authority in the nations of the world, that there may be justice and peace on the earth. Give us grace to do your will in all we undertake, that our works may find favor in your sight. Have compassion on those who suffer from any grief or trouble, that they may be delivered from their distress. Give to the departed eternal rest. Let light perpetual shine upon them. We praise you for your saints who have entered into joy. May we also come to share in your eternal kingdom. And now we come together to pray for our needs and those of others. Lord, this morning we pray for our church here at Trinity, and we pray, Lord, that you would grace us with your Holy Spirit for a time of renewal for each of us as individuals as we long for life again after COVID, for the return of our members and the renewal of our congregation, and the renewal, Lord, of our mission in the neighborhoods around us. We pray for our country and throughout our country, Lord, we pray for those people who have lost friends and family members due to COVID, nearly 550,000 people. Lord, as we begin to move toward our sense of spring and optimism, Lord, we also remember that so many are grieving the loss of people they have loved. We pray for those who are suffering with long-term effects from this disease. We pray for those who are in mourning, and for those who this has increased their anxiety and made their issues of depression or mental illness or addictions worse. We pray for your grace. We pray for those who this day are searching for you, Lord, for those who are seeking God and not sure where to look. We pray for every seeking heart this day, and we pray that we might be aware of them, Lord, that we too might be a light to show them what we have found. We pray, Lord, for healing for all kinds of issues this day, allergies, COVID, people who are dealing with cancer or other diseases. We pray for those who have been affected economically, who are dealing with issues of rent and mortgages or food insecurity. We pray especially, Lord, for something which has been an issue that we have yet to solve for the last 40 years in our country. We pray for the issue of immigration, particularly at our southern border. Lord, we pray for all those countries where the poverty and injustice is so bad that people would leave their homes and walk across an entire country in order to get to our borders. And now, Lord, we have thousands of people, including many, many young people and children, who have sought to find a way to get here, Lord, and we don't know what to do. We are praying for mercy and provision for them, and for you give us a wise solution. We're praying, Lord, for our preparations for Holy Week. We lift up to you all those women who are pregnant and new moms dealing with their births and as they prepare for their births, getting ready during this time of COVID. And we also, Lord, pray for people who are near to our hearts this day. And Lord, we pray this morning for this list, which is simply people we know who are dealing with cancer today. So we lift to you Brogan, Tara, Marie, Bob, Mark, Donna, Jim, Mike, Kathy, Anita, Brenda, and Courtney. And if today at home you or know of someone who's struggling with cancer that I didn't mention, please mention those to the Lord even now as we pray. We also pray, Lord, for others who are close to us. We pray for Vincent, who is facing a big heart surgery on Tuesday. We pray for Doug for his recovery from heart surgery 2 weeks ago. We pray for Hannah and Lisa. We pray for Judy and her son, Chris. We pray for Kelly and Hunter. We thank you for the twins. And now we pray that you would assist them in finding a new house. We pray for Charles and Jim, for Larry and Peter, Laurie, for Shirley, Tim, Deb, for Joan, for Steve, for Cameron, and Raleigh. We also pray for Bob and for Beth. And we pray, Lord, for all those who are entrusted with the responsibility of brothers and parents who are dealing with other issues. And so we pray for all those who have to care for other family members. If there are other prayers that are on your hearts today, just take a moment. And in great faith, just go ahead and say those prayers out loud right now. Mm-hmm. We also pray, Lord, we give you our thanksgivings for your goodness to us, remembering today especially, Lord, just how great it feels to feel the sun come up and to see flowers emerging from the cold, Lord. Thank you for spring. Thank you for answered prayer. We thank you for the technology that we have for doing these services. We thank you for folks after an entire year of hardly being seen by their families, and now people in assisted living being allowed to hug their family members. Thank you, Lord. And we also thank you for the blessing of grandmothers and for the blessing of being grandparents. Thank you, Lord. And now let us pray again. Lord Jesus Christ, you said to your apostles, "Peace I give to you, my own peace I leave with you. Regard not our sins, but the faith of your church, and give to us the peace and unity of that heavenly city, where with the Father and the Holy Spirit you live and reign now and forever. Amen." And now the peace of the Lord be always with you. Before we move to our communion time, just a couple of quick announcements. One, we were able to meet this morning. It was a little brisk at first, but it really warmed up. So we are back again meeting outdoors. And I think we're only about just a number of weeks away from being able to resume some partial indoor worship. As you know, and I say in the e-blasts, that despite the fact that the governor said that houses of worship could go back to full capacity, the little footnote C below says, continued at 6-foot radius distance with masks. No singing from a choir. So I understand we all want to get back. We are so close right now, but we don't want to stumble at the finish line. And we're still under the other guidelines as well. So we will begin to come back. We're just going to continue to work. More people are being vaccinated. Just hold on a little bit longer, and we're going to be able to make it. And you can join us outdoors. It really is a great service outdoors. Next week, we're beginning Holy Week with Palm Sunday. And so we're going to have people right now are distributing palms. For those of you who'd like to fold them, they're all going to go out. Neckers at the toy store, they're going to be offering palms that have been blessed to people in the community. Last year, they gave away 125, just people in town who heard they had them. And so we're continuing to it became a ministry of palms. Who knew? So we have, just prepare yourself for Holy Week and to look at the schedule as it comes. If you're not on our mailing list and you'd like to be on our mailing list so you can keep up with what's going on, simply you can write something in the chat right now, send in a little message there on Facebook, and we will be able to get your information and get you that and get you connected to on our e-blast, which comes out every Friday and lets you know what's going on. Last announcement. You know, we have a close relationship with Tariffville School down the street. And this time the request didn't come from the principal, but came from our very own Mackenzie Jem, who teaches there and works with special ed kids there in the sixth grade. And so what they need this time is 25 calculators because I think kids took them home, lost them, can't find them. So they needed a quick redo for 25 calculators. We've ordered the calculators. They're $7 a pop. If you'd like to be able to be a part of that, so far, I think we have committed about $140. It's about $240 for all of them. So you'd like to be a part of that, go ahead and send a check into the church and say, "Hey, I'd like to buy one. I'd like to buy two." Whatever you'd like to be able to do. And that way we can continue to kind of help them out. And we'll just see what the Lord continues to do in our relationship here with our neighbors in town. Okay? Great. So now walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us an offering and sacrifice unto God. Thank you. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who was tempted in every way as we are, yet did not sin. By his grace, we are able to triumph over every evil and to live no longer for ourselves alone, but for him who died for us and rose again. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels, with all the company of heaven who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy and gracious Father, in your infinite love, you made us for yourself. And when we had fallen into sin and become subject to evil and death, you, in your mercy, sent Jesus Christ, your only and eternal Son, to share our human nature, to live and die as one of us, to reconcile us to you, the God and Father of all. He stretched out his arms upon the cross and offered himself in obedience to your will, a perfect sacrifice for the whole world. On the night he was handed over to suffering and death, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Recalling his death, resurrection, and ascension, we offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, the holy food and drink of new and unending life in him. Sanctify us also that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament and serve you in unity, constancy, and peace. And at the last day, bring us with all your saints into the joy of your eternal kingdom. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ, by him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to pray, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen." Christ, our Passover, is sacrificed for us. Therefore, let us keep the feast. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Grant us peace. And now, since we are unable to be together to receive this Holy Communion, I invite you to pray with me the prayer of Saint Alphonsus, saying, "My Jesus, I believe that you are present in the most holy sacrament of the Eucharist. I love you above all things, and I desire to receive you into my soul. Since I cannot at this moment receive you sacramentally, come spiritually into my heart. I embrace you as if you were already there and unite myself wholly to you. Never permit me to be separated from you. Amen." Now, if you'd please join me in this great prayer of thanksgiving, saying together, "Almighty and ever-living God, we thank you for feeding us with the spiritual food of the most precious body and blood of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and for assuring us in these holy mysteries that we are living members of the body of your Son and heirs of your eternal kingdom. And now, Father, send us out to do the work you have given us to do, to love and serve you as faithful witnesses of Christ our Lord. To him, to you, and to the Holy Spirit, be honor and glory, now and forever. Amen." And now I pray that Christ might fill your life so much that your lives might be a light to the world. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen. And now please join in our final song for today, Blessings. Desperately, and long that we have faith, So thanks again for being with us today as we worship online, whether it's Sunday or Monday or Thursday. We do want to hear from you. So go ahead and just take a moment just to write like a just something in a text line and let us know. And if you'd like to learn more about our church community or how you can be a part of it, even at a great distance, please go ahead and send something in. We'd be glad to talk to you. So now we're praying for you for this week. There's a lot going on in our world. And we are thankful that we're walking with God. So now let us go in peace to love and serve the Lord. Thanks be to God.